This is a short follow-up video to the recent banking crisis. I knew that I forgot to include something, and it was that last year in August, according to the Catholic News Agency article, Pope Francis instructed Vatican entities to move all funds to Vatican Bank by September 1st. So it reads, Pope Francis has ordered that the Holy See and connected entities move all financial assets to the Institute for Works of Religion, commonly known as the Vatican Bank. I will skip the second paragraph. According to Francis' rescript, financial and liquid assets held in banks other than the IOR must be moved to the Vatican Bank within 30 days by September 1st, 2022. So, don't you think it's a little weird? And this wasn't really shown anywhere in the media. I tried to find some kind of news announcement in a video format, but I couldn't find anything. It's as if they didn't want to inform anyone what they were doing. And they did it extremely quickly. But of course, we know better than that. We know what's going on. And on March 15th, of course, World Economic Forum, they announced that... Rather, they asked the question, as digital currencies become more popular, could we be seeing the end of cash? Well, obviously. So, I will leave this article below for you to read. They get into very, very dangerous stuff.
Let me ask you, we're all friends here, right? What kind of a situation are we in? What are we actually seeing here? We understand that there's an issue here, clearly, with the global banking system. Okay, but what does it boil down to? I'm gonna read something to you real quick. This is from CNN Business. Now, I want you to focus on what I'm about to say. See if you can pick up on what this paragraph is trying to outline. If you have been with me for any length of time, a light bulb is about to go off in your head. So this is this paragraph here from CNN Business. The US Federal Reserve and several other major central banks announced a coordinated effort to boost the flow of US dollars through the global financial system with the aim, hold on, of keeping credit flowing to households and businesses. Are you starting to see the bigger picture here? I don't know for how many years, but it's been a long time. I have outlined to people that we are going to face a credit crisis. This is exactly what we're seeing here. It's interesting how it's just it's a play on words. Credit and debt being one and the same here. It's kind of an interesting thing. So we're seeing now a phenomenon of central banks pumping the system full of more debt or currency here. And again, no matter how much they put in here, it will never, ever be enough. Why? Because the number is constantly growing. The amount that must be pumped into the system must grow. So understanding this, we are in right now a full-blown credit crisis or a liquidity crisis. Okay, how do we know that? Well, because that's what's going on here. Central banks pumping the system here. You got central banks around the world now who are involved in what's something called a currency swap. In other words, the European Central Bank is sending euros to the Federal Reserve. The Federal Reserve is sending dollars around the world. Now, this is not a secret here. If you followed this blog for any length of time, you've heard me tell you for years that the Fed is funneling dollars around the world to central banks around the world, and these central banks are using those dollars to buy assets. Now it's coming to light that that's exactly what's going on here, and central banks are trying to provide liquidity to the system. Why? Because liquidity is drying up. Does this sound familiar? Bells and whistles going off. I've been explaining this to you since I don't know how freaking long. So this statement here from CNN here, again, to boost the flow of dollars through the global financial system with the aim of keeping credit flowing through households and businesses. You see, what people forget, really, when people look back on the meltdown of 2008, the big meltdown, it wasn't so much that the market was crashing. It really wasn't. It was the fact that credit was locking up. There was no inter-business, interbank lending going on here. The system was about to freeze, a credit freeze. A credit freeze, this is what they're trying to prevent here. Their aim is to keep credit flowing. So what is that telling you? If this does not succeed, and I think it's going to fail by design, we're going to end up in a freeze situation, a locking up of the system. That means transactions stop. You could, checks don't work, debit cards don't work, you can't get your cash out of the institutions, ATMs, nothing works. It's just over. What will work, and I've been telling people to keep a little cash around here in the case of a credit freeze, cash would work. If you were to go to an institution and say, I need milk, I need eggs, who knows what the price of them will be at that particular point, you could use your cash to transact, but nothing else. Credit won't work. You understand? So that's what's going on here, people. We are in a full-blown liquidity crisis, a credit crisis. They are desperate right now to prevent a locking up of the system. And you all know this. If you've been with me for any length of time, this is where we're going here. Although we did see some cash go into the equity market today on the promise of unlimited liquidity, okay, by central banks. And what we're not being told is this is hyperinflationary, okay? You and I have covered right here on this blog, I don't know how many times, repeatedly, how we, with regard to inflation, we haven't seen anything yet. As I'm going to tell you right now, a tsunami of inflation is going to hit the world. It's global. And this is not by accident. Again, central banks are in no fight at all to stop inflation. If they really want to stop, slow, or reverse inflation, they could contract the money supply. But you will never hear about this. Not even a syllable, not a word whatsoever from the mainstream propaganda ministry. They can't allow you to know that. I want to cover a few things with you. So all of you understand this so-called rescue of First Republic Bank, this is how it was sold to the people. This is a rescue. There's $30 billion, thank you, 11 Wall Street banks to supply the rescue First Republic. It was never a rescue, okay? Never. All this was, there's a run on that bank right now. There's a run on a lot of banks right now. You're not allowed to know that, but First Republic is a run on the bank. That $30 billion was only to cover withdrawals. That's all it was. Now, First Republic, their stock was halted from trading multiple times today. It was down 50% at one point today. Okay, so don't believe a word, and I know you don't, from the mainstream propaganda. A rescue? It's a rescue. No, they were just these mega banks said, "Hey, you know what? We're going to get this money back anyway in the form of deposits. So let's throw $30 billion into First Republic. People are going to withdraw it and put it right into the big institutions, exactly how it's going." And here's another interesting thing, and this isn't going to surprise you. It's starting to get some coverage right now, and I want you to, you know, look this up for yourself. So hundreds of banks at risk of collapse. Duh. Thank you, Jeffrey. Yes, many hundreds of banks around the world, it's probably maybe in the thousands of banks, are at risk here. But you can't know this here. But the hundreds of banks, this particular one was hundreds of banks at risk.
This is Zoe. Just like you, she uses lots of different cards and IDs to get through her day. What if all Zoe needed was herself? Introducing Amazon One, a free service that lets you use your palm to quickly pay for things, gain access, earn rewards, and more. Let's say you're grabbing your favorite coffee beverage, or heading into the office, or checking out. Just hover your palm and you're on your way. It's as easy as that. Sign up is free and takes less than a minute. All you need is a credit card, your phone number, and your palm. That's it. Since your palm is unique and can't be lost or misplaced, you can get things done quickly and securely. And with more experiences on the way, Amazon One will help you get even more done simply by being you. Now, Zoe has more time to do what she loves, indoor skydiving. Enter, identify, and pay with Amazon One.
What's going on? Rich DeMuro here, Rich on Tech, at the Amazon bookstore at the Century City Mall. And they've got this new way to pay that does not require anything except your palm. Well, you got to register a credit card, but you can go into this store and shop with literally just your hand. And Amazon calls it Amazon One. I call it the amazing palm reader payment system. But basically, once you register your credit card, when you come into the store, you shop around, and all you have to do is wave your palm over this little reader, and you can check out. So I've identified something I'd like to purchase here for my son. This is a little reversible plushie, which probably costs more than I should spend on a little stuffed animal. It's like 15 bucks, but it's so cute. Look at it. It's like happy, mad, and you can change, I guess, based on how you're feeling at the time. Anyway, so I'm gonna check out with this little device, or with the Amazon One, and see how this all works. So let me go up here, and so I've already registered my credit card. The registration process is pretty easy. You literally just put a credit card in that is registered to your Amazon account. It will recognize that. You hold your palm, your left and then your right over it. And look at that. With this, you can actually see some of the lights in there that's using infrared to scan your palm. And Amazon says they wanted to use the palm scanning technology because it's less identifiable than anything else in your body. So it's not your facial recognition. It's not fingerprint recognition. It is actually palm, which realistically you don't really use for many other recognitions. All right, so there is my little tea turtle, it's called. Total is $16.43. And all I have to do now is just put my hand. It doesn't matter which one, right?
Nope, you'll be set.
Okay, so I'm gonna, it says pay with my palm. And you see that little red light? That's it. That was that fast.
That was that fast.
And so it just shows my email address right here. Click it, and it says thank you for shopping at Amazon Books. And that is it. Awesome. Got a receipt emailed, and that is how fast it is to use this thing. That's all I need, huh?
Yep, you're all set.
Okay, thank you. Receipts in the bag.
You get an email one as well.
Oh, and I get an email one as well. Okay, so that was pretty easy. So what do you think? Are you ready to use your palm to check out? I mean, it's kind of cool if you have like a store locally, like, you know, a little convenience store down the street or something that you just go to quickly. You don't need your credit card. You don't need to take anything out of your pocket. I don't know. It seems to work pretty well. Do you think it's going to take off? Let me know in the comments. All right, there you have it.
So here we go. Ready? Once again, the global financial system finds itself in a crisis. This is how the mechanism works. Crisis to crisis. You know this. Indeed, a new full-on worldwide financial system banking crisis is upon us, and it's just getting started. Look at the videos that I did just prior to this SVB bank meltdown. I wrote in the titles, systemic meltdown. The system is finished pretty much. I've been telling you this for the longest time, but now it's coming to light. Now, this is really where I want you to pay attention, okay? Let us consider. This is where how I want to show you there's a literal crime in progress. A crime in progress. And you and I are the only ones paying attention. Is it even remotely possible that the banking regulators and central banks simply missed what we're seeing right now? Meanwhile, we, the people, you and I, we saw this coming. Is that even possible, really? How about no? There is absolutely no feasible or realistic way that banking regulators and central banks could have not seen this coming from miles away. And here are just a few reasons why. Okay, you're already aware of this stuff, but now it's going to come together for you. Let's start with this. Every bank, all of them, is required to submit financial reports to the regulatory authorities every quarter. And moreover, even without seeing these reports, it's plainly obvious that banks were failing because of just three things. At least 3 months ago, I started explaining to people there was a problem here. Three problems. No deposits, no loans, and no deals. Since I knew that, and you were all aware of this, do you really believe that banking regulators didn't know this? Oh, it gets way better. Nor did the central banks. Let's move forward. I brought these three things listed above to the attention of those who follow my work beginning no less than 8 months ago. Of course, they knew it as well. Now, just to put this into a further perspective, listen to this. The average savings rate, which is calculated as the percentage of cash which people put away after expenses, thank you, Tyler, is 8.84%. That's the average. Now, keeping the average in mind, today the savings rate has dropped just 4.7%. And personally, I think this number is grossly inflated. Why do I say that? Because people are borrowing just to make ends meet at their fastest pace ever. Meanwhile, they've also depleted, we'll talk more about this, depleted money market accounts. They've depleted their savings accounts. So this number is definitely inflated. So the savings rate has been almost cut in half. Thank you, Matt. With respect to no loans and no deals, year over year, mortgage applications have dropped a record 43%, and bank refis have dropped another record 74%. And on top of all this, loan delinquencies across the board continue to skyrocket. So you tell me, you try to convince me, banking regulators didn't see all this coming. They didn't know it was coming. Central banks, they had no idea. Janet Yellenstein, who thinks, what did she say? Janet Yellen today. Oh, this is beautiful. Yellen, quote, are you ready? Liquidity is strong. Personally, I think she wet herself. And that's why she's saying, ooh, liquidity is strong. I just wet myself. Liquidity is strong. Liquidity is drying up. We're in a full-blown liquidity credit crisis. But she wants you to know that she's all wet down there. Liquidity is strong. Anyway, let us move forward here. But it gets even worse on top of what we just covered here. People are withdrawing cash from the money markets and savings accounts at a record pace. Yeah, that's going on. So no, it is not possible, not even in the remote, that those who stand in charge of the world economy, the banking system, and the markets just missed all this. Therefore, it is deliberate. In fact, it is more than just deliberate. Here we go. I'm almost done with this, so just bear with me, all right? The entire banking system crisis / global financial system collapse has been perfectly orchestrated and engineered by central planners being central banks. But why? Okay, why? The question of why comes down to just a few things. Central banks are rearranging the deck chairs, so to speak, and it comes down to a consolidation of the banking system in preparation for the rollout of an entirely new central bank digital cashless system. This was a clear example. UBS taking over Credit Suisse, and we're going to see a lot more of this kind of stuff happen. The regional banks, they're all going to get sucked right into the mega institutions. It's also about a consolidation of power. Understanding, pay attention to this, okay? Understanding that even the super banks are also facing the same issues as the smaller regional banks with no deposits, no loans, and no deals. That situation, combined with rising loan delinquencies, and let's of course not forget about the flight of cash from money market accounts and from savings accounts, because people can't cope in this, you know, surging, raging inflationary environment, which is about to get monumentally worse. Think all this liquidity crisis that. It's amazing. What a paradox. When in a liquidity crisis, the system is illiquid, central banks pump the system full of more liquidity, and no matter what they do, liquidity is still drying up. It's what you would expect to see in a moment of maximum saturation, something I have discussed with all of you we've covered right here repeatedly for freaking years. Understand? Unbelievable. This is a deliberate culling of smaller institutions to consolidate power and control into fewer mega institutions and a rearranging of the deck chairs in preparation for the rollout of central bank issued digital currency. You will work for digits on a screen, which you won't own anyway. There's really almost no difference between the dollars in your pocket. You don't own these things. They're owned by the issuing central bank. We owe them back to the issuing central bank plus interest they create out of nothing. That's the system. It's incredible. Let us remain mindful that for many months, central banks have been on a mission. Oh yeah, they're on a mission to aggressively raise rates into what is a cratering global economy. Raising rates under the guise that this is how they will stop inflation, which continues to rise.
And lastly, guys, this AI technology, artificial intelligence, is getting bizarre. I'm talking about deepfakes, AI-generated voices. I knew those things existed, but you have to see this one. It's getting scary. You can't even trust your eyes anymore. So check this one out.
What should be done with him?
I don't know.
I don't think that's true. I think you have some very definite ideas about what should be done with Danny, and I'd like to know what they are.
Well, I think maybe he should be taken to a doctor.
You think maybe he should be taken to a doctor?
Yes.
When do you think maybe he should be taken to a doctor?
As soon as possible.
As soon as possible.
Jack.
I've said many times on this show that you should trust nothing and verify everything. Now, that's particularly true of what you see on the internet or you actually hear from politicians and the mainstream media services. People like Keith Pitt excluded, because he's straight with us all. But that's become even more important as artificial intelligence is becoming more advanced, making it just about impossible to work out if what you're seeing and hearing is actually true. Now, one chap who knows a lot about this is the media and communications expert and advisor, Hamish McLachlan Lester. Before I get to him, though, have a quick look at this.
Is it true that you have dementia?
Here's the deal, Jack. I may be 80 years old and I may have a few drops of dementia here and there, but I'm sharper than a steel blade and vibrant enough to outsmart the best tech geniuses around. Look, I was the one who helped pass Obamacare and the assault weapons ban, and I'm not going to let anyone question my intelligence or clarity of judgment. It's dark Brandon time. Now I have access to China and Russia's infrastructure, plus the FBI, CIA, and Pentagon. Let's get real. You think you've seen me rise to the top? Think again, Jack. I'm ready to throw these greedy ass Republicans in jail and show them who's boss.
That's incredible. What we saw there was entirely fabricated, Hamish, and yet it rung true for many people. How hard is it to do this sort of deepfake video?
Look, just quickly, thank you for having me on. And in terms of that video, it's not only that it's just a deep fake, it is a real-time deep fake that is responding to a question.
So the broader context was there was a person interviewing three deep fake videos and they were responding in real time, and that was one of the things. So it doesn't have to be pre-programmed or pre-created or pre-recorded. You can actually create a virtual Joe Biden and make it say anything you want.
Exactly. Now, to do that level of it is obviously harder, and it's not an out-of-the-box method, so you're going to have to learn how to code or use some other coding AIs. But there are out-of-the-box ones that you can use to just replicate your face and have it talk.
And it will make up the words itself, so based on a pattern of speech and move your lips accordingly.
Exactly.
So what does that mean for people when they're looking at information on the internet or they're listening to a politician or something that's gone viral through one of the social media services? How can they rely on the authenticity of what they're seeing?
Well, look, you can't. And that's the biggest thing, right, is how are these platforms going to transition into having reliable sources? And what they're moving towards now is verification. So you can see that with what Elon did on Twitter and having the blue tick that you pay for, as opposed to it just being about people of notoriety. And Facebook and Meta, Instagram has brought that out now as a subscription model to be verified. And I think it's bigger for content creators more than just consumers of social media.
So it wasn't, I just thought it was a money grab, to be honest. They're all trying to prop up their balance sheets, but there is, I guess, a reasonable standard that they want to uphold to say you can rely on this person because they've created this content for themselves. Because the reality is that you've shown me technology where you could create a virtual Corey Bernardi, you could create an entire show around me not even being there, not even feeding the content, no pre-written content. It would just be based on the news of the day and what people perceive my views to be.
Exactly. That's what's possible. Now, to do that easily, it still is hard, but give it one more year and all this will be really like off the box, you know, like your Apple product version of it will be out. and available for people. But
sure,
it's not all bad.
I'm sure there's some benefits to it, right? But let's just focus on the potential for harm here, because I'm cynical enough, I've been around too long to realise that all these technological breakthroughs aren't misused by someone. And I see it as a tool of giant propaganda, because I'm going to presume the best people at this would be the tech firms, those who have access to the tech firms like government. We can't rely on what governments tell us. We've seen that with the Ukraine war. Both sides will mount that their version is accurate. The US will say another thing. Have we seen this misused for propaganda purposes so far?
I can't be 100% sure, but in terms...
That's how good they are.
Yeah, well, that's how good they are, right? But if it's more like, because you have these troll farms in China, Russia, probably the US as well. So it's more of a, if it hasn't been done, it's a matter of time that it will be done. And it's just about the time, the right time to deploy it.
Okay, now we've also heard about things like ChatGPT, which has been created for university students to cheat on their exams. Not really, but that's what it's being used for a lot. There are other sorts of systems out there, aren't there, that people can access just off the cuff. What sort of technology are we talking about?
Look, it's actually really cool. So you can put in some words, say you want to make a presentation about a particular topic, and then it will generate a whole presentation around that topic. So if you're doing a business meeting or whatever, you can generate that in a matter of like 30 minutes, an hour, and edit it. But then there's also things like Midjourney and DALL-E 2, where you can prompt it to say, I want a Van Gogh style painting of Cory Bernardi. And it can make that instantly, and you can actually have hyper-realistic ones. So stock footage will be a thing of the past, because this is all original content. But the coolest one that I've seen so far is Merlin, which attaches to your browser, will read your emails, and it will prompt your response. So whenever you get stuck at writing an email, it's a thing of the past now.
Winning underscore patriarch is asking, Elon Musk, does it get uncomfortable to wear a human skin suit for long periods of time? How often do you need to shapeshift back to your lizard form?
Yes, the human skin suit. It's like a second wardrobe for me. It's definitely not comfortable, especially when I'm shapeshifting back to my lizard form. But Neuralink has been working hard on a project to develop a new species of synthetic skin that grows with its wearer, thereby eliminating the need to shapeshift back and forth. In the meantime, I'm really looking forward to SpaceX's launch to take us on a trip to Mars in 2029, so I can finally enter my full lizard form in zero G. That is truly an exciting endeavor for sure.
Hardcore, Joe Rogan, what happens when you give DMT to a chimpanzee?
Dude, did you know that when you give a chimp DMT, they can time travel? That's wild. Well, there's this guy, Ronald Millette. He's out of the University of Connecticut, if you Google him. He says that chimpanzees on DMT are capable of going back in time to save their loved ones. It's entirely possible. I mean, Jamie, can you pull up some more info on that? But check it out. It could be a game changer for the human experience. It's fascinating. My man, we may be able to travel through time one day.
Bye.